about the situation in Darfur.
In other words, is all this a gigantic conspiracy among a large number of NGOs who have some agenda in Sudan? Because a number of people are saying this. How can all of them, either they have all got a conspiracy and an agenda, or all of them are wrong? What's your judgment on that, sir?
Indeed, one of the reasons why this importance being given to the Darfur issue by the administration is to divert attention from real problems in Iraq and in Afghanistan. This is our impression in the Sudan, because they succeeded to some extent to divert the attention from what is going on, the killings of the sons and daughters of this great country in Iraq. So they wanted to divert the attention by talking about the issue of Darfur. If you take it by the number of dead, let's say that the dead in Darfur are the 200,000, as they say. In DRC, 2 million. But you don't have safe DRC. You have only safe Darfur. And about safe Darfur, they are most, they lack credibility, because at last they quarreled with each other and they removed their boss and they embezzled a lot of money. Millions were collected to help Darfur, and in the pretext of helping Darfurians, but they took this money to their own selves, and they fired, as you know, the boss of the Save Darfur coalition. So this organization, according to us, lacks the credibility, operational one, because they were not able to send even a can of powdered milk to Darfur, whereas they collected millions and millions, and they can publish every day in the New York Times and the Washington Post advertising worth thousands and thousands of US dollars. So it's a very, they lack the credibility in our judgment.
Thank you. Professor Hull, do you have a question?
Yeah.
And also, you said like the governor of New Jersey, but former President Carter knows the situation very well. He was in Sudan. If you listen to him, last week he was saying that it is not a genocide. So you have also some respected figures in this country who are stating the facts as we see it in the Sudan.
Ambassador, you've mentioned several times now rebels. Yeah. But I'm curious, who are these rebels? What are they rebelling against? And what is the Sudanese government doing to put down the rebellion?
Essentially, the rebellion started in Darfur in 2003. Started as banditry actions and activities by bandits. As I said, the history of the region showed a lot of environmental degradation because of prolonged drought. And the issue was a struggle over resources. This struggle over resources also led many to take arms to defend the tribe or to defend the economic interest, though meager, of this group or that group. From banditry group, groups, it developed into political groupings like the Justice and Equality Movement, it's called GEM, and Sudan Liberation Movement, SLM, all claiming that Darfur has been marginalized, long marginalized, and there should be restructuring of the Sudanese state. So that those dominating the elites in the center should give a chance to others from South Sudan, from the West, from the East, and from other corners of the country. As I said, it is essentially an economic, it has economic root causes. This is why all those rebel groups are talking about equality, about justice, about representation, about compensation, about redemption. But they are also affiliated with some influential groups at the center. Justice and equality movement is known to be very much close to Hassan al-Turabi, one of the Muslim fundamentalists in the country. He's very well known. And he's a man who actually in the early 80s invited Bin Laden to the country. So you have that whole history behind. There are some political issues involved, but many of them are calling for equality, for redemption, for averting marginalization, establishing justice in the country. But there are many. They are mushrooming every day, multiplying every day. From four major rebel groups, there are now about 18 groups. So the issue, the difficulty facing Mr. Ilyasu now is to group together those different rebel groups and to try to unify their positions in the talks, which is also proving very difficult nowadays.
To the back on this side.
Why are your soldiers executing innocent women and children?
Are you executing innocent women and children?
No, we are not. We are very peaceful. Very, these are part of the rumors and the accusations which we see every day in the Western media. I can assure you that nothing of that sort happens in the country. No responsible government slaughters their own citizen, because there is no reason for that. If the government is credited to end the longest civil war in Africa, in South Sudan, bringing the CPA, what benefit does it get by waging war against Darfur or against its own citizen?
Yes, sir, out in front here.
The respected, one of the most respected science journals internationally, Science, recently estimated using sophisticated techniques how many people died, including controlling for things like disease, starvation, other natural deaths, and came up with the figure 200,000. The second point I would like to, or question I'd like to ask you is, if you deny there is a sort of group called the Janjaweed, that is a series of militias that more or less consistently work with the government, and that these are every one of these groups, militias, has a Janjaweed, then why would the government of Sudan agree to commit, in fact, as part of this process, forthcoming peace process, to rein in the Janjaweed, has so far failed to do so, but there was a commitment. So why would you agree to rein in something which doesn't exist?
First, about the number, I insist that this number is not authentic at all by all standards. Recently, the advertising authority in the UK stopped all advertising, paid advertising by pro-Darfur solidarity groups, claiming that this number is 200,000, because they question the authority, the British authority on advertising, question the credibility of those figures, and they stopped publishing statistics on the figures of the dead. But I hope that when war ends in the country, then we can come, the truth will come, but it is between 10 to 20,000, unfortunately. Not all of them in combat situation or in military operations, but many because of diseases, and in sub-Saharan Africa, the major killer is not the guns, but the malaria and HIV and others.
To the back again.
Janjaweed